We also have another very special speaker with us, Professor Lab, who is currently the VC of Nav Nalanda Mahavira and is also been the former Dean of Sanchi University. He shall be speaking on the topic of rewriting of Pali and early Buddhist thought and philosophy. I would now like to formally invite the chairperson to conduct the proceedings of the session. I would like to invite Professor Pandey for his analysis on the topic.
Respected Sir, Professor S.R. Bhatt, and Vice Chancellor of Sanchi University, Professor Shastri, and friends. I would like to initiate a discussion on a new area which I think is in Indian philosophy, and that is intentionality of consciousness. Precisely, I have taken a topic, this topic, because for a long time I have been thinking about the notion of consciousness in Indian philosophy, and I thought that apart from Charvaka and Nyaya, who these two schools in Indian philosophy regard consciousness as a quality of soul, as well as in the case of Nyaya, and consciousness as the quality of body in case of Charvaka. So this is the one side, and another side of the story is that Sankhya, Yoga, Vedanta, and Buddhism, they regard consciousness as not a quality of soul, but which transcends even bodily existence of soul, that is jiva, and that they don't maintain it as only limited to the bodily existence of soul or bodily existence on this earth as in case of Charvaka. So basically the dichotomy, I was thinking for a long time, and I got hold of one text from Jain Mohanty, and then I was encouraged to think in this area. Now, what is intentionality of consciousness? Basically, I would like to go straight to this. In the last line, that in presentation, something is presented. In a judgment, something is affirmed or denied. In love, something is loved. In hate, something is hated. In desire, something is desired. So this is basically intentionality of consciousness as described by Brentano in Western context, that is phenomenology. But intentionality basically there is treated as the relationship between act and consciousness. So in act, consciousness is, there is nothing, no consciousness over and above the action. But this basically, I think, was the idea taken by Jain Mohanty, with whom I disagree. Jain Mohanty thinks that...
Don't talk of Mohanty, to talk of Lokayata and this.
Okay, sir.
Although
now coming to state power, this is very long topic, and what I find is that in case of this classification is something not accepted by me, Mohanty's classification, and in case of Charvaka and my objections, I'm skipping that to Mohanty and coming to state power, as sir is saying. So I'm skipping so many slides, going directly to Charvaka and debate between Charvaka and Charvaka and Buddhists. That is the crux of this discussion, what I have formulated. And the crux is this: the Charvaka Pariksha is a text in the book Tattva Sangraha of Shantarakshita, and this debate is quite deep. Charvaka holds that the consciousness is savisayak, that is, there is intentionality of consciousness, and consciousness is intentional always. There is no consciousness apart from body. But Buddhists hold a different kind of perspective, and this dialogue between Charvaka and Buddhists in the case of this text, I have divided into two classes. Number one, there is an identity between body and consciousness, and number two, basically body is the cause of consciousness. So these are the two, under these two headings, basically, two topics, I have divided the debate, entire debate between Charvaka and Buddhism. In the first debate, that is, there is identity between body and consciousness, I have formulated 5 points. And the first one is like this. This stroke number 1858 of this text, that is Tattva Sangraha, that is, consciousness must be regarded as produced from certain material substances, as just as fermented acids, liquors, and such things. This is the first argument. Out of five, this is first given by Charvaka, and this Buddhist, basically, they reply to this, and they say that this is not the this is not the position, and this consciousness cannot be regarded as limited to body only. This is my first reply in 1859, that is the Karika of Tattva Sangraha. And then Charvaka comes again and it says that there is no consciousness apart from such things like body, sense organs, etc. And then this is the sloka Karika number 1860. And then Charvaka again says that from this it follows that right point is that consciousness proceeds from the body itself, which is equipped with the five life's breath, that's prana, apana, and the rest. Then Charvaka reconsiders, and then again Charvaka is, I have quoted here, and then again Buddhist reply is there in this, that is the next point in the five points. And Buddhist reply is that there is no consciousness in fetus. This is significant part of the argument of the first heading, that is there is identity between body and consciousness. So this whether there is a consciousness in fetus or not, this is basic argument between Charvaka and Buddhists. And Buddhists say that there is no consciousness in fetus, but Buddhists say that there is a consciousness in fetus. So this argument is there, and Buddhists say that you cannot say that there is no consciousness in fetus, and Buddhists, they have their own arguments on this. Because then Buddhists have then the different level of argumentation, and that is Buddhists say that in state of paralysis, etc., even though there is a change in the body, there is no change in the subjective consciousness. Hence, this latter cannot be regarded as subsisting in the body. So this is the argument of Buddhists, that in case of paralysis, any illness in body, still the cognition is there, and there is no harm to the cognition. And then on this basis, one of the basic significant point of this text, in this argument, in this line of argument, is that Buddhist basically Shantarakshita supports linga sarira concept of sankhya. It says that linga sarira has to be accepted because conception of linga sarira of sankhya has to be accepted because this is the concept of migrated body, and the concept of migrated body can be accepted only on the basis of transcendental consciousness. So this is the argument, five arguments given in the first section, that is body and is equal to consciousness, the debate between Charvaka and Buddhism. The second line of argument, that is second topic I have for this presentation. There are 8 points of argumentation, sir, between Charvaka and Buddhism. And the first argument is that Buddhists hold that there is no causality between consciousness and body, and hence consciousness is not identical. On the other hand, according to Charvaka, the cause of consciousness is body. And the dialogic argument begins in the following way. The first argument Buddhists they are putting, so that is, according to Buddhists, the appearances of the feelings, love, hatred, etc., do not take place due to the presence of any external cause. Because even when these stimuluses are present, the feelings in question do not appear. And that is the reason that they say that the feelings of love, hate, etc., basically this is not based on the stimulus according to Buddhists. But Charvaka denies this, and it says that in the next slide, this is very, very basic argument of Charvaka, if objects are not stimulus of feelings, then how is it that feelings of love, etc., appear only when objects are present? This is the basic argument. This is the second argument of this second topic of this presentation. And then basically Buddhists deny this, that the stimulus could be the cause of the feelings in human beings. They say that had this been the case, there would have been the occurrence of a single affliction from an object like that happens in the case of perceptual cognition of the form of blue color, etc. And to quote this 1954 Karika of Tattva Sangraha, says that as a matter of fact, however, a single affliction is not what actually appears. For instance, in regard to a single object in the shape of the body of the women, while in one man the feeling is aroused, that of love, in another man is hate, while in another man is jealousy, etc. So this argument given by Buddhists, that stimulus could not be regarded as the cause of the feeling in a human being. And then Buddhist basically reply again, and I'm not going to do that detail. And then again, Charvaka basically gives an argument against this. And Charvaka says that the feeling of love, etc., that appears during the present life cannot be the effect of repeated experience in the past as they arise. Because Buddhists, they accept that the feeling basically, they appear because of the past experiences. And Buddhists basically deny this, and because they accept, Buddhists accept Cartesian theory of innate ideas. This is pretty interesting to look into this aspect of the resemblances between Indian and Western philosophy, that whether the ideas which is born in the child at the time of birth, basically these ideas could be traced back to past life or not. In the West also there is a controversy as to whether the ideas in the mind of the child is could be traced back to past life or not, because there is a debate between Locke and Descartes. I'm not going to that. But here, I think this is a new area where I can myself go into that more detail in that, and find that as to whether which is more rational. And then again, this Buddhist reply is that on that we have to look into the concept. The Buddhist reply is quoted here: the application of the feeling cannot be due either to the perceptual doings of others or hearing from other persons, because such is not found in the case of always. It is saying that boars, bucks, and other animals who have never seen the heart of doings become perturbed by the touch of the female. So this, like, basically is the cause of the dialogue between Charvaka and Buddhists, that Buddhists basically hold that the stimulus cannot be regarded as the cause of the feeling in the mind, whereas Charvaka accept that stimulus is external and that could be regarded as cause of the feeling in the mind. And then Charvaka's objection to the above is that what happens that in case of it is regarded as love, hates, etc., in the feeling, basically that is, there is the material explanation of that. And this material explanation could be traced to the particular combination of atoms of body, that is, love basically is flame, is and related to flame, and bile basically is responsible for hate. And this could be traced back to testosterone. I mean, this medical science also has kind of endorsing Charvaka's point of view, because testosterone has a positive relation with sexual behavior of human beings. And then this Buddhist reply is that we are reaching to the final of all argumentation. And Buddhists say, hold that origination of feelings cannot be due to the film, etc., because if that would have been the case, then film and bile would have been the positively related. The increase in one would have been the increase in the other. But what happens that in case of the increase in the bile, basically love is increased. And in case of increase in film, basically increase of hate is there. That is, the reverse relation also is found scientifically. So that is why this explanation is not acceptable according to Buddhists. Now, what is the position? We have to look into it and see that what is the exact condition. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Pandey, for bringing into our consideration Charvaka, rather Lokayata, Buddhist controversy. There are two contributions of Lokayata to Indian thought. One is in the field of epistemology, raising doubt with regard to inferential cognition and primacy of perception, which we shall be discussing with Professor Arun Mishra. The other one is in the field of metaphysics, wherein Charvaka's regard consciousness as an epiphenomenon of matter being the only primary reality. And then the other contribution of Charvaka is advocacy of yadrichhavada, denial of any necessary causal connection, accidentalism. In fact, in this controversy, the background is that of yadrichhavada. And so far as consciousness studies are concerned, we have twofold approaches in our thought. One is consciousness, qua consciousness, and other is consciousness of. Consciousness, qua consciousness means consciousness itself is the ultimate reality as it is there in the Vedantic thought. But consciousness of means consciousness is always conscious of some object. So there is a built-in intentionality in consciousness, and therefore a basic distinction is drawn between consciousness as a knower and the object which is to be known. So this is a dualistic position advocated in Buddhism. So in Buddhism, for example, in among the panchaskandhas, which constitute human personality, rupaskandha is physical, but vijnanaskandha is a you can say consciousness, and so accordingly they maintain a dualistic position, bhuta and bhautikas, chitta and chetikas, chetasika. So consciousness is independent of rupa, matter. And matter is independent of consciousness also. The two are original constituents of human personality and also of the cosmos. So the Charvaks advocate materialistic monism, whereas the Buddhists would advocate a sort of a dualism. And this dualism is advocated by Vaibhashikas and Sotantrikas, but not by the Vijnanvadins. Vijnanvadins again are say monistic, and for them consciousness alone is the ultimate reality. And so far as the Madhyamikas are concerned, they don't want to commit this way or that way. So they are known as Madhyamika because of this, also known as Shunyavada in a different sense, that they don't believe in the ultimate reality of the empirical world. So this controversy is there, and if there are any questions or queries, you kindly please mention this.
When we are using the Western category like intentionality of consciousness to Indian context, I feel that the problem has to be a little further extended. Now, with regard to this of consciousness, as very beautifully said by our professor, but this is not a problem, because we always say that objects are in relation to consciousness. So in order to know a particular object, that of relation plays a dominant role. So whether it is the Charvaka or the Buddhist, this is not a problem. But I think the main concern for, I mean, there are Indian phenomenologists like R. Balasubramaniam who have been making an attempt to look at the problem from Indian perspective. Now, they would say, where does the Indian philosopher come in with regard to this problem of consciousness or intentionality of consciousness? They would say that whether there can be an object without consciousness, this is one issue, or whether consciousness exists as separate thing, that is, it has nothing to do with the object. This is exactly the problem with the Vedanta. Now, two models are very much available in India, Vedantic tradition. I think that has to be celebrated. One is the Advaitic, very beautifully in Mandukya Upanishad, it has been stated, all the three states of experience, the object exists outside, so there is no problem. So they will not have any quarrel with the Western tradition or the Charvakas or the Buddhists. But the problem is, when they talk about the Turiya, where consciousness alone exists, then that is something unique. I think this is where the Indian philosophers differ from the Western counterpart like Brentano or Husserl or anything. I think that has to be, exemplified. And secondly, you see the dialogue between the Advaitins and the Ramanujais, where Ramanujai would say, the Vishnuvaitins would say, no, it is not possible. The abstract consciousness which you are talking, that is Advaitins, they claim, is something which is abstract. And there are some Vishnuvaitin scholars who argue that there is no use of having such consciousness. So Ramanuja would come very close to Husserl or this thing. But I feel that the main contention of Indian philosophers, when we are probing into the Western concept, I think we have to show how rich our tradition is, how we are better than the Western counterpart. I think that's where we can highlight the Indian tradition.
And contentless consciousness could be called consciousness. Is it real consciousness? That is the problem. Contentless consciousness.
Yeah, I said, it's a very beautiful concept. See, this deep consciousness, there is also consciousness. But why, you know, because this is what my teacher said. Pardon? The intentionality is there, but you know, it will be like that. A person who awakes from consciousness, he would say, I slept very well. I don't know what happened. I slept very well. So when he makes a statement that I slept very well, from it is known that he had consciousness. Right? So, all the three states of consciousness.
Now, please, no mutual discussion. You, let him, please let him finish and then you take up. Please follow a particular order. You will have a chance to speak, but one by one only. But let it be made clear that in Indian tradition, a clear distinction is drawn between pure consciousness, which I call as consciousness, qua consciousness, and embodied consciousness. It is only embodied consciousness which has intentionality, and that intentionality might be there at the waking state, it may be there at the dream stage, it may also be there in a latent form. We use the word latent in the deeper sleeper state. So this is the classical position of Indian thought. But let us concentrate on this controversy between Charvaka and Buddhism. That's more important. Yes.
Intentionality of consciousness arises only when the mind is functioning.
Yeah, yeah.
In Sushupti, the mind relapses.
That is over then. But about this controversy, you please say something. Don't explain that.
No. Advaita, it is always Nirguna.
You forget about that. You come to the point.
It is always Savisesha.
Madam, come to the point about this controversy. If you have to say something between Charvaka and Buddhist, then you say. Otherwise, other things you can discuss later on.
That he has already made.
That's all then.
Already
any other one
clear
on this particular issue?
I am strongly more inclined with the Lokayuta than the other interpretation of Buddha. Even the other interpretation of Buddha is also leaning towards the Lokayuta. My whole problem on this is how to be aware of that consciousness of qua consciousness. What is the method to have at least a shadowy or at least some sort of a hint that it is there. To my mind, that is more of a metaphysical presupposition rather than realized to non avidya. I find that is not at all tenable. And from the example that you have given, the Pitta does not have any consciousness at all. And even in the paralysis, well, the organs are already formed except that has been deformed. Therefore, the consciousness level also goes down there, even in the embodied consciousness. Therefore, from the embodied consciousness, to have a feel of, even intuitively, the pure so-called consciousness, qua consciousness as such, as an existing ontological entity. I find that is extremely difficult to have the feel. Therefore, I feel that the Lokayuta position is stronger. That's my comment.
Buddhists do not accept a reductionist position of the Charvaks. Charvaks reduce consciousness to matter. Buddhists say that no, the Bhuta and the Chitta are separate and independent, like the Sankhya system. The only thing is that in the Sankhya system, Purusha and Prakriti are permanent, whereas here Bhuta and Chitta are in a constant flux. Second point of difference is about causality. Whether our thoughts, our feelings, our emotions just erupt without any causal conditions, this is the Charvaka position. That they just have occur. Maybe because of the force of the circumstances, whatever it is, but they say it is a matter of accident only. Whereas Buddhist advocate Pratitya Samutpada, where everything is having a causal origin, and therefore this is another point of controversy. So if you have anything to say on this, please. Whether this accidentalism of Charvaka is acceptable or not.
Sir, I would like to hear in this case of the second kind of argumentation, that is causality argument. Basically, the case is slightly sophisticated here, because Buddhists do not accept any kind of causality between consciousness and body. On the other hand, Charvaka basically, Lokayata system, basically they accept that there is a causal relation between. And I have quoted because they say that this cannot be reduced to the causal relationship, and the causal relations Antarikshita has been explaining in a slightly different manner, as the causal relation has been found in Indian philosophy. Because according to Buddhists, basically the causal relation not in the sense of that is cause and effect, but they say that body basically is the cause of consciousness according to Charvaka, but Buddhists say that body cannot be regarded as the cause of consciousness. Basically this, on this point, the debate is there between Charvaka and Buddhists here in the second line of argumentation in this Tattva Sangraha. But then I would like to take the first question asked by Professor Paneerselvam, and thank you very much, sir, for this nice observation and as well as suggestion. I basically agree totally with you, because this is the point that on this point only I have given my reply to J.N. Mohanty. Because J.N. Mohanty basically took the Western notions and he has classified Indian position in the context of intentionality of consciousness. Basically, this is the Western notion, and he has not gone detail, as you have rightly pointed out, the state of Turiya. The state of Turiya. And the second point, Professor Jha has very rightly pointed out that Turiya, and I suppose that there is a need to look into the afresh as to what would be the notion of intensity of consciousness in the case of Turiya. And then Professor Rao, is there contentless consciousness? No, there is no contentless consciousness according to?
No, mutual discussion you can have later on. Now I request Professor Arun.
I am deeply obliged to Sanchi University, who has given me the chance to speak before you people. Secondly, I am obliged to the institution, particularly Delhi University, where I have been taught how to do philosophy and how to understand philosophy. So, to both the institutions, I am deeply obliged. Here, first of all, I will explain how I do philosophy, when I do Nyaya. And for that purpose, since the article is written in Hindi, therefore, I may kindly be allowed to speak in Hindi. प्रथमतः जब आप या मैं अध्ययन करता हूँ तो मेरा कंसर्न केवल मौलिक ग्रंथों पे रहता है, और उस जब मौलिक ग्रंथों को मैं देखता हूँ तो उसके अंतर्गत जो विचलन, ये नहीं है कि वहाँ पर एक सरल रेखीय गमन नहीं पाया जाता है, वहाँ पर युक्तियों का विस्तार होता है, एक भाष्यकार से वार्तिककार भिन्न हो जाते हैं, वार्तिककार से टीकाकार भिन्न हो जाते हैं, और टीकाकार से परिशुद्धि के जो उदयनाचार्य हैं वे भिन्न हो जाते हैं। तो ये भिन्नता ही उनकी विकास को सूचित करता है, और यही भिन्नता तंत्र, जिसको मैं तंत्रांतर्गत भिन्नता कहता हूँ, वे सभी सूत्र को स्वीकार करते हुए और अपने पूर्ववर्ती को कहाँ से वे भिन्न हो जाते हैं और उसके प्रसंग में उनकी क्या युक्तियां हैं, वे ये प्रस्तुत करते हैं। भाष्य वार्तिक तात्पर्य टीका एवं अनुटीका के शैली में उनका लेखन शैली भी कुछ भिन्न होता है, तो ये पद्धति मैं फॉलो करता हूँ। इससे फायदा मुझे ये होता है कि बहुत सारे ग्रंथ नहीं देखने पड़ते। द्वितीयतः इस लेख, यह एक उदाहरण, लेख तो एक उदाहरण मात्र है। द्वितीयतः जब मैं और कोई मौलिक ग्रंथ देखता हूँ तो देखता हूँ कि भाई यहाँ तो विचलन नहीं, यहाँ तो बिल्कुल भिन्नता है, और यह भिन्नता न्याय के कम दो संप्रदाय तो निश्चित रूप से हैं। एक को मैथिल संप्रदाय यदि माने तो दूसरा कश्मीर संप्रदाय है, जहाँ पर जयंत भट्ट और भाषाविज्ञ है। तो वहाँ पर भी अगर देखने को देखेंगे अगर मौलिक ग्रंथों को, तो वह दो पुस्तक वैसे अनुपलब्ध है सामान्य जनों को। एक आया था, सर आपने एक लिखा था कि न्याय को वेद के कंटेक्स्ट में कैसे देखेंगे, उस प्रसंग में 1890 ईस्वी में निर्णय सागर प्रेस ने एक पुस्तक छापा था जहाँ पर कि न्याय की वेदानुसारी व्याख्या है, और वह पुस्तक मुझे उपलब्ध है दिल्ली में। और दूसरा है रुचि टीका, रुचि टीका है जो कि जिसका अनुसरण भाष्यकार सॉरी ये जयंत भट्ट और भाषाविज्ञ करते हैं। तो यह जो जब तक की भिन्नता और विचलन नहीं पॉइंट आउट करेंगे, तब तक हमारा जो तत्काल या कंटेम्पररी लेखन है वह एक तरह से सरल रेखीय गमन में चलेगा, कुछ कह नहीं पाएंगे। क्या हमने अपना सिस्टम में, हमारे सिस्टम में क्या वैशिष्ट्य है, ये हम नहीं कह पाएंगे। इसी उद्देश्य से ये बहुत सामान्य रूप से लिखना छोड़ के और कोई मेरा काम है ना तो लिखते रहता हूँ, तो उसी क्रम में यह लेख उपलब्ध था जब यहाँ से मुझे, जी हाँ। तो मैं सीधे सीधे संशय सूत्र में आ जाता हूँ। संशय सूत्र है कि समान धर्मोप, इसका मैं विग्रह कर रहा, समान धर्मोपपत्ते, अनेक धर्मोपपत्ते, विप्रतिपत्ते, उपलब्धेह अव्यवस्था, अनुपलब्धेह अव्यवस्था, और विशेषापेक्षो विमर्श संशय। अब इस सूत्र को भाष्यकार कहते हैं कि समान धर्मोपपत्ति से संशय होता है, अनेक धर्मोपपत्ति से संशय होता है, विप्रतिपत्ति से संशय होता है, उपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था से संशय होता है, और अनुपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था से संशय होता है। अब यह तो भाष्यकार का मत है और उन्होंने अपनी एक्सप्लेनेशन दिया है। अब यहाँ पे वार्तिककार इनसे भिन्न हो जाते हैं। वार्तिककार कहते हैं कि इसमें तीन ही हेतु हैं, समान धर्मोपपत्ति, अनेक धर्मोपपत्ति और विप्रतिपत्ति, और यह जो उपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था और अनुपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था है वे इन तीनों का विशेषण है। अब तो इसमें और बकिए जो दो पद हैं वे हैं जैसे कि विशेषापेक्ष, विशेषापेक्ष का मतलब कि विशेष की अपेक्षा करना, और वह एक स्मृति को, स्मृति के बिना अगर यदि आपको स्मरण ना हो तो संशय नहीं संभव है, इसी को विशेषापेक्ष कहते हैं। तो विशेष की अपेक्षा करना, और विमर्श, नाना अर्थ अवमर्शनं विमर्श, जो एक ही समय में अगर एक ही वस्तु में आपको अनेक प्रकार नाना अर्थों का विमर्श होने लगेगा, अवमर्श होने लगेगा, तो उसको विमर्श कहते हैं और तब संशय होता है। ये दो संशय के लक्षण हैं। और अब दो भाग हो गए यहीं पे, भाष्यकार पांच मान लिया, वार्तिककार तीन मान लिया, और बकिए दो को उन तीनों का विशेषण कह दिया। अब समान धर्मोपपत्ति को लेकर के भी चर्चा है। अब समान धर्मोपपत्ति में क्या है कि क्या समान धर्मोपपत्ति में, ये रुचिकार का प्रश्न है वास्तव में, ये रुचिकार पूछते हैं कि क्या यहाँ पे अव्यवच्छेद हेतु का, इसलिए कि आप जब समान धर्म कह देते हैं तो क्या व्यवच्छेद हेतु है या अव्यवच्छेद हेतु है, तो अव्यवच्छेद हेतु का समावेश आवश्यक है। इस प्रश्न का उत्तर फिर परंपरा में दिया गया है। हाँ, अब मात्र समान धर्म का ज्ञान संशय है। अब देखिए, चूंकि भाष्य ने भाष्यकार ने पांच हेतु मान लिया, उपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था और अनुपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था, तो क्या ये और वार्तिककार ने उनको तीन ही हेतु माना? तो अब ये प्रश्न उपस्थित होता है वार्तिककार से लेकर के उदयनाचार्य तक कि क्या समान धर्म उपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था, अनुपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था समस्त रूप से संशय का हेतु है या असमस्त रूप से या दो दो करके है? तो इस प्रश्न पर वहां से लेकर के उदयनाचार्य तक चर्चा है। और इसमें वार्तिककार कहते हैं कि आपको तीनों को समस्त रूप से, मतलब समान धर्मोपपत्ति को साथ उपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था और अनुपलब्ध की अव्यवस्था होनी चाहिए, फिर अनेक धर्म के साथ भी वे दोनों समस्त तीनों समस्त रूप से संशय के हेतु बनते हैं। अब सबसे कंट्रोवर्सियल पॉइंट वहां पर अनेक धर्म है। अनेक धर्म की जो व्याख्या की गई है वे तीन तरह से की गई है। पहला तो अनेक को वे असाधारण धर्म के अर्थ में ग्रहण करते हैं, पहला। दूसरा, अनेक को अनेकस्य धर्म के अर्थ में ग्रहण करते हैं। तीसरा, अनेक को अनु में नए समास से करते हैं। तो इन तीनों की जो व्याख्या है, उन तीनों की व्याख्या में इन चारों न्यायिकों में, चार नहीं मतलब कि जो अब मैं उद्योतकर ऑनवर्ड ले रहा हूँ, उद्योतकर, वाचस्पति और उदयनाचार्य में बहुत अधिक भिन्नता है। और इस में वैशेषिक आ जाते हैं, कूद पड़ते हैं। वैशेषिक इसलिए कूद पड़ते हैं कि वे कहते हैं यहाँ पर क्या है, तो कर्मजन्य ये विभाग की जब संकल्पना करते हैं या अनेक विभाग की जब संकल्पना करते हैं तो वैशेषिक यहाँ विभागज विभाग की संकल्पना कर लेता है और विभाग विभाग को विभाग का निमित्त कारण मान लेता है, और वाचस्पति और उदयनाचार्य अनेक धर्म की मैंने क्रिया कर्मज विभाग को कर्मज कहने के क्रम में, जबकि अनेक धर्म की व्याख्या विभाग को कर्मज कहते हुए जब करते हैं तो वे कहते हैं कि विभागज विभाग की संकल्पना यहाँ नहीं की जा सकती है, और यदि आप करते भी हैं तो वे विभाग का निमित्त कारण नहीं है अपितु शब्द का निमित्त कारण। वे इसलिए कि शब्द इसलिए आ जाता है कि अनेक धर्म की व्याख्या करने के समय में शब्द का जो संशयत्व स्थापित करते हैं वे उस शब्द के असाधारण धर्म, शब्द के असाधारण धर्म के आधार पर वहाँ संशयत्व स्थापित करते हैं न्याय, और वे शब्द के जो असाधारण धर्म के आधार पर उसमें वैशेषिक नित्यत्व स्थापित करते हैं। इसीलिए विभागज विभाग और कर्मज विभाग की चर्चा फिर शुरू हो जाती है ग्रंथ में। इस प्रकार से विप्रतिपत्ति और फिर विप्रतिपत्ति की भी चर्चा है। अब वैशेषिक के विभागज विभाग की संकल्पना का खंडन करते हैं ये वाचस्पति और उदयनाचार्य, वहाँ पे बहुत अधिक युक्ति का विस्तार देखा जा सकता है तत्परशुद्धि में। और फिर वे कहते हैं कि अनेक धर्म की जो अन्य व्याख्याएं थी वे दोनों संभव नहीं है, नए समाज से संभव नहीं है और अनेकस्य धर्म से संभव नहीं है, बल्कि अनेक धर्म को असाधारण धर्म के अर्थ में ही ग्रहण करना चाहिए। और ये कैसे होता है तो वे उसका उन्होंने युक्ति दिया है कि द्रव्य क्या गुण और कर्म से भिन्न है, गुण क्या द्रव्य और कर्म से भिन्न है, और इसी तरह से द्रव्य गुण कर्म, कर्म क्या द्रव्य एवं गुण से कर्म से भिन्न, इस तरह का संशय का उदाहरण देते हुए वे विभागज विभाग का खंडन करते हैं न्यायिक। विप्रतिपत्ति हेतु की फिर उद्योतकर जो हैं वे संशय के पांच हेतुओं का खंडन कर हेतु के तीन रूपों की स्थापना करते हैं। तो ये लेख का पहला भाग है जो काफी विस्तृत है। द्वितीय भाग में मैंने उपस्कार को लिया है, वैशेषिक सूत्रोपस्कार। वैशेषिक वैशेषिक ना कह के, इसलिए कि मैं जबकि समान तंत्र की व्याख्या वाचस्पति खुद करते हैं तो उनकी व्याख्या का अनुसरण करते हुए वैशेषिक को न्याय का ग्रंथ माना जा सकता है, इसीलिए मैं उपस्कार को न्याय का ग्रंथ मानता हूँ। यदि यदि समान तंत्र की जो व्याख्या वाचस्पति की जो व्याख्या है उस व्याख्या को स्वीकार करते हुए शंकर मिश्र के उपस्कार को मैं, वैसे उसका नाम तो है, उन्होंने तो उपस्कार कहा हुआ है, बाद में एक एडिशन आया वे बनारस से बहुत पहले, वहाँ पर उपस्कार है, ये बाद में ढूंढीराज शास्त्री उसको, उनको शायद वह ग्रंथ देखा नहीं था, फॉर्चुनेटली वे सारी पुस्तकें मेरे पास है, तो वह ग्रंथ पता नहीं उनको कि 1910 ईस्वी में कोई छपा हुआ है सरस्वती भवन से, तो उन्होंने उसका जो टाइटल दे दिया जो चौखंबा से है, वैशेषिक सूत्रोपस्कार। तो लेकिन ओरिजिनली वे उपस्कार है, और उस उपस्कार को मैं न्याय का वाचस्पति का अनुसरण करते हुए न्याय का ग्रंथ मानता हूँ। अब इनकी क्या वैशिष्ट्य है, इन्होंने वे साफ कहते हैं, जी हाँ बस मैं उनका एक पंक्ति में केवल, हाँ, तथा च संशयो न त्रिविधो नवा पंचविध किंतु एक विध एव। संशय का जो तीन हेतु हैं उससे संशय को तीन प्रकार कह दिया गया, और जो पंचविध मानते हैं जैसे भाष्यकार वे संशय का पांच प्रकार कह दिया, और शंकर मिश्र कहते हैं कि ना तीन है ना पांच है बल्कि एक है। अब उनके लिए यह आवश्यक हो गया कि सूत्र में जो पांच संशय का हेतु है और वे कहते हैं कि वे है क्या, तो समान धर्मोपपत्ति है, बस यही है और कोई नहीं है। अब शंकर मिश्र उपस्कार में क्या करते हैं, तो रिमेनिंग जो फोर है उसको समान धर्मोपपत्ति में अंतर्भूत कर देते हैं और उसकी वे उदाहरण प्रस्तुत करते हैं, और फिर वाचस्पति का और उदयनाचार्य के मतों का खंडन करते हैं उपस्कार में। वहाँ पर संशय सूत्र है उपस्कार में भी। तो इस तरह से हम देखते हैं कि समान तंत्र में भी यदि हम मौलिक ग्रंथ से पढ़ते हैं तो कैसे युक्तियों का विस्तार हुआ है ये हमें देखने को मिलता है, और कैसे लोग समान तंत्र कहते हैं वैशेषिक को, इसीलिए मैंने समान तंत्र कह दिया टॉपिक में, समान तंत्र में भिन्नता कैसे हो जाती, और यही इसी के बल पर मैंने कहा कि मध्य युग में शंकर मिश्र सबसे प्रभुत्वशाली न्यायिक के रूप में उन सभी में सभी को खंडित करते हुए प्रभुत्वशाली न्यायिक बन गए। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू वरुण मिश्रा जी, ही हैज डेलिनिएटेड ऑन द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ डाउट एज इट इज डिस्कस्ड इन द सिंक्रेटिक न्याय वैशेषिक ट्रेडिशन। डाउट प्लेज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रोल इन एक्विजिशन ऑफ नॉलेज। इन एपिस्टेमोलॉजी we are concerned with the reflection upon our experiences. Every experience, if it is to be reflected on, is reflection of an object. And it's quite possible that we may apprehend the object as it is or different from what it is. That means in our cognitive enterprise we may go astray, and therefore always there may be a doubt as to whether our apprehensions are true to the nature of the object, are deviated from the nature of the object. Entire epistemological inquiry begins from this only. Had all experiences been veracious, had there been no possibility of error, epistemology would not have begun. So, in Indian tradition, before Pramaya Shastra, we always have a Pramana Shastra as a propaedeutic. Now, so far as a doubt is concerned, well, what is the nature of doubt? What are the causes of doubt? What is the impact of doubt? And how doubt can be eliminated? In fact, we have a vast literature as to how doubt is to be eliminated. We therefore should concentrate in our enterprise when we are writing history of Indian philosophy as to the role of doubt. Of course, causes we should take into account, whether they are samana dharma or viparita dharma or vipratipatti or upalabdhi or anupalabdhi. Upalabdhi and anulabdhi are subsumed under either samana or viparita or viruddha dharma. There need not be any much controversy over that. But the question is how doubt can be eliminated, not only in the context of perceptual cognition, and therefore we have different theories of khyati for elimination of error or doubt concerning the truth of a cognition, but more important is with respect to generalization, empirical generalization, on which that is vyapti, on which the entire inferential process is grounded. And this has been a point of controversy in the the problem was raised by the Charvaks, the Lokayatas, about doubt. And this doubt has also been voiced by Bhartruhari in his Vakyapadiya, as I said yesterday. Now, the Buddhists gave one type of answer to that, and the Nayayikas gave another type of answer to that. But whether both the types of answers are satisfactory or not is a matter of deliberation. We have to discuss as to whether Samanya Lakshan Pratyasakti is acceptable to us or in Bhuyo Darshana, because this is another alternative, Bhuyo Darshana. Samanya Lakshan Pratyasakti is Sakrit Darshana. Single apprehension will be enough for removal of the doubt. But sometimes we require repeated observation. But in the repeated observation also, can there be conclusiveness? That's a point of controversy that we have to discuss in our writing on the role of doubt. And there is two possibility. One is resolving doubt, and the other is elimination of doubt. It has been argued, and Vachaspati Mishra in his one of his works regards the Shankha Pishachini. Pishachini. Shankha is regarded as Pishachini because you cannot eliminate doubt. You can only resolve doubt for practical purposes. Again, this is a point of deliberation among us as to whether doubt can be eliminated or not. If doubt cannot be eliminated, then there cannot be any conclusiveness in our epistemological inquiry. And if doubt can be eliminated, then only because in the West, there is a problem of induction, inductive leap, how from some we can jump to all. And instead of certainty, which Cartesian thinkers talked of, they developed the idea of probability. Well, can we have some similar position in Indian epistemology as well? Some sort of probability that to a certain extent, under certain circumstances, we may take it to be true, otherwise it may not be true for eternity, forever. So, question therefore to be debated is, it was Gangesha who talked of elimination of doubt instead of resolving. But then again, the question was raised particularly in Khandan Khanda Khadya by Sri Harsha. So controversy is there, and we should deliberate in our writing on Indian epistemology on this particular issue. I know I want, for 5 minutes we can have some discussion on that.
So following the line, a clue from Professor Bhatt, I would like to tell that if there is elimination of samsaya at all, then philosophy dies. No philosophical growth is possible. That's why Udayana told Noisha Shanka Pishachini, not only that, he told emphatically, Shanka Chet Anumasteva, Nachet Shanka Tatastara. Had there been doubt, you will have inferential cognitions, more and more philosophical deliberation. And if Shanka is dead, then philosophy is stagnant water. No more questions will come. You yourself told that between Bhashyakar and Bhartikar, there is a lot of difference. Due to some elimination of doubt, by way of elimination, they are imposing some points of doubt. So doubt is always welcome in philosophy. That's why Udayana Acharya said, Shanka Chedonu Masteva. Another thing Professor Bhatt forgot, perhaps, that Tarka is also another method of elimination.
Doubt can be eliminated or not. That is a more important question from epistemological point of view. That is, we must make a distinction between sufficient evidence and conclusive evidence. Is it that we should be satisfied with sufficient evidences only? Our Praman Shastra should deal only with sufficient evidences and cannot give conclusive evidences. Or it can give conclusive evidences as well. And this question arises only in the context of what is known as avidya. In context of vidya, the question will not arise. In intuitive apprehension, it is indubitable. We say all is swatah praman. It is self-evident. Only where evidences is required, and that is at the level of empirical apprehension, there only the question of doubt arises. This is Indian position. With vidya, no doubt. Otherwise, if you start doubting about vidya, then sanshayatma, vinashyati, that will be the position. This is Indian. But about empirical, doubt is encouraged. And we must keep on doubting, and credit must go to Lokayata for that.
Ye jo pankti aapne kaha hai, ki ubhay dharma nishth prakaratavan sansaya. अब ये यह जो है संशय, वह इसका सामान्य अर्थ तो ये है कि संशय कब होता है, जबकि उसमें वह जो प्रकारता होगी उसकी, वे उभयनिष्ठ होगा, वे उभयनिष्ठ होगा. अब संशय में दो चीज़ें ये नहीं हो सकता कि एक का प्रावल्य होगा और दूसरे का दुर्बल्य होगा. अगर एक का प्रावल्य हो जाएगा तो संशय ही नहीं होगा. एक का प्रावल्य अगर हो जाए, अगर हम स्थान या पुरुष देखते हैं, तो हमें यह प्रावल्य अगर हो जाए कि वक्रकोटरादि अत्र विद्यते, यदि अस्य प्राधान्यम तर्हि तत्र संशयो नास्ति. यदि प्राधान्यम नास्ति तस्मिन् नैव स्थिते संशयो भवत्. तो प्रावल्य जो है, प्रावल्य होने से एक का प्रावल्य होगा तो दूसरे का दुर्बल्य होगा और उस स्थिति में संशय नहीं. तो जहाँ तक कि यह जो है, एक तो अपने आप में यह पंक्ति जो है सो लोडेड है. इसलिए लोडेड है कि देखिए, प्रकारता जो है, यह वैसे वाचस्पति से शुरू हो जाता है, लेकिन प्रकारता की जो एक प्रत्यय है, वहां पर इसको विशेषण के रूप में प्रयोग करते हैं, तो फिर यह माने यह जो एक पद बन गया है वह धर्मनिष्ठ प्रकारतावान, यह यदि इसे ही एक्सप्लेन करें तो संभवतः कम से कम 15-20 मिनट तो मुझे लगेगा।
वैसे एक बात बताऊं मैं, हमारे यहाँ पर नहीं बस छोड़ दीजिएगा, हमारे यहाँ पर धर्म में और प्रकारता में अंतर किया गया है। जो प्रामाणिकी परिषद तद्वती तत्प्रकारकत्व, तो तद्वती वहाँ पे वत्त जो है ना वो धर्म को ले आता है और तत्प्रकार जो है ना वो धर्म के ज्ञान के लिए आता है। पहला विशेषण है, दूसरा जो है वो ज्ञान के लिए आता है। तो ये कंट्रोवर्सी है, इस पर हम अभी नहीं जाना चाहते, लेकिन एक बात बताना चाहूँगा कि संशय जो है वह द्विकोटिक भी हो सकता है और अनेक कोटिक भी हो सकता है। तो द्विकोटिक होगा तभी तो आपका दौर्बल्य या प्रणाली की समस्या आएगी। अनेक कोटिक हुआ तो बहुत सारी कोटियाँ हैं उसमें आपको, तो इसको अंग्रेजी में बोलते हैं कि वेदर देर इज इंटरनल अल्टरनेशन और एक्सटर्नल अल्टरनेशन, और वेदर इट इज हैविंग ए क्लोजनेस और ओपननेस। ओपननेस में है कि आइदर ए और बी और सी, एनीथिंग कैन बी देयर। तो ये एक कंट्रोवर्सी हमारे यहाँ पे रही है इस पर विशेष। अब समय की सीमा है, वैसे तो हमें 1 बजे समाप्त करना था, लेकिन हमें नहीं, आप थोड़ा समय लीजिए, आप 15 मिनट का समय लीजिए। प्रोफेसर लाभ को हम कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट करते हैं, ये नवनंदा महाविहार विश्वविद्यालय के अब इसको वाइस चांसलर कहते हैं, वो अभी हुए हैं, भार संभाला है, और पूरी संभावना है कि अगला एशियन फिलोसॉफी कांग्रेस और इंडियन फिलोसॉफिकल कांग्रेस का सेशन जो है वह इनके यहाँ पर होने की संभावना है।
रिस्पेक्टेड प्रोफेसर भट्ट, प्रोफेसर शास्त्री जी एंड ऑल डिग्निटरीज सिटिंग ऑफ द डायस, आई एम नॉट कम प्रिपेयर्ड विद एनी डॉक्यूमेंट और एनी पेपर, बिकॉज इन माय हम्बल ओपिनियन इन अ वर्कशॉप देयर शुड नॉट बी पेपर रीडिंग, rather we must raise some questions, some thoughts, and there must be more and more discussions. So I found that particularly the early Buddhism and Pali has not been focused in this, has not been given its due importance, although the Pali texts, most of the texts have been edited and translated, but I have because being a student of Pali and early Buddhism, I have found that there are a number of discrepancies and misinterpretations created by Western scholars not only regarding Buddhism, but regarding the whole Bharatiya tradition. And because of the fact that there is a basic difference between the outlook of Western philosophy and Bharatiya philosophy. They are basically more or less individualistic and academic, whereas Indian philosophy is based on realizational practices, meditational practices, adhyatmikta. And that's why we find that the ultimate truth cannot be explained. It can be realized only within heart of hearts. The Buddha also says, samahito yathabhutam pajanati. A person who is well meditated or well established in meditation, only he can or she can realize it within hearts. And number of philosophers, even Nagarjun and all others, they have also said about nirvana and all that. There may be or there are different perceptions of moksha and nirvana. I'm not going to into that controversy. All of us know about that. But the basic difference that lies between the Western philosophers and Bharatiya philosophers, that should be redressed, that should be deliberated upon, and a 190 years of our dependence that captivated our mind and just influenced our mind so much that most of the scholars gave up their original thinking and they became slave of Western scholars. There is a need now. I'm very happy, I feel very happy that a very number of good scholars are coming up with an independent and Bharatiya thinking. We must see our history, we must see our philosophy, we must see our ancient literature in our own way. We have a different tradition, and as I have pointed out, that our tradition is based on spirituality, and that should be emphasized. That will be a right thing, or that will give us opportunity and a scope to understand ourselves in a better way. Regarding sometimes these days particularly, I have found regarding Buddhism has been painted or is being painted as anti-Sanatan tradition. In my humble opinion, whatever I have understood, Buddhism is not simply, or it has not come from the some vacuum. It had its background in the Sanatan tradition. Siddhartha Gautam lived a household life till 29 years of his age, and since he was a prince, he must have gone to the school or gone to some teachers. What he read about all those Vedas, all those Sanatan tradition books and texts, whatever form they were, he left his household life, we all know, at the age of 29, and he went to Alar Kalamai Kudra Kamput, basically Sankhya teachers. He meditated under their guidance. Of course, after some time, he did not feel satisfied. And here, the element of doubt also comes. Because unless until we have doubt, we cannot go ahead. So he did not feel satisfied. And he shifted to Bodh Gaya, what we call today Bodh Gaya, Uruvela, forest of Uruvela. He meditated there for long years, many years, and he found out the truth in his own way. What we may call today the Four Noble Truths. And because he gave a space to doubt, he always advocated that rationality must be there. Faith is, of course, very important, because he says, Shraddha Bijang. Shraddha, mera seed hai, bij hai. Or in our day-to-day life also, if I don't have any faith in you, whatever good you are saying, I will not believe. I will simply reject it. So in our day-to-day life also, there is importance of faith. And what to talk of in the field of spirituality. So the Buddha himself says that don't take my words blindly, because I am saying. You just ponder over it, listen to me, you ponder over it, and ponder over it very thoroughly. And when you get convinced, then have a firm faith, and then practice spirituality or meditation and all that. So faith is very important, but we have to differentiate between the blind faith and faith. Of course, after some time, that faith also comes blind, and there is a point comes when that rationality and argument has to be put to rest. So that way, now I'm just coming to this Pali literature in which we find the original, believed to be the original words of the Buddha, Pali Tripitak. And we find that many things have been translated or interpreted by the scholars in different way. Of course, Munde Matir Bhinna is there. There may be differences. But sometimes we depart from the original or basic fundamental teachings of the Buddha, fundamental concepts of the Buddha. And that's why we find that initially there was Theravada, then Mahayana developed, many Mahasanghikas, and 18 sects by the time of Ashoka developed, and we all know about that. Even Mahayana and Tantrayana, Mantrayana, etc. developed. So that is there, that is a, I take it as a development. And that will be there in every philosophy, in every thought, every school of thought. It will happen, otherwise knowledge will stop. So we have already discussed this point. So that should be there. But sometimes what happens, particularly in our country, we find that there are some people who have totally or fundamentally departed from Buddhism. And they have painted it as anti-Sanatan or anti-Dharma, anti-Hindu, what we call today. That is sometimes, that pains. And such scholars I have found, they never try to go to the original texts, original sources. The Buddha, of course, denies the existence of Creator God and all that, but he very much believes in the karma and rebirth theory, kamma and patsandhi. And Professor Bhatt Sahib was talking about mind and body, roop and naam roop. Naam roop, of course. There is naam and roop also in Pali literature, and naam stands for mind, or that, and that can be, these two can be further analyzed or divided into five, panchaskanda, roop, vedna, sangya, sanskar, vijnan. Roop is the physical part of our existence, or our, and vedna, sanskar, vijnan, etc. Four, these are part of naam. They are separate, but they are interdependent also. Mind cannot exist without roop. And roop has no money, no meaning without naam. So, anya manya upanishata ete gachanti. Like that, there is, we find in the Pali literature. They both go, though flow like a river. And as a river, we find that ignorantly or in practical manner, we say that we have taken five dips in the Ganges, in the river. But Buddhism talks that it is not possible to take five dips in the same river, because it flows, it flows, it flows. It seems to be the same, but it flows every moment. And because there is no gap between the previous one and the later one, so they seem to be the same. So Buddhism also believes in that. And those scholars who have tried to look at Buddhism with the so-called progressive mirror, with them there is a big problem. Otherwise, if we try to see or try to study Buddhism in the traditional manner, taking into the whole Indian tradition totality, I don't think there will be much problem. Of course, there are different traditions. Buddhism has its own tradition. The Buddha never claimed that he is spreading or he is establishing something new religion. He never told that. He was born a Kshatriya. He meditated and found got enlightenment. But he never said that I have got something new religion or new philosophy. He, of course, rectified the existing tradition. Of course, he was against the dogmas, the then dogmas, the Pashubali and all that, violence. So he rectified all those, and he died. When he was dying, Ananda asked him, how should we dispose of your body? He never said that you just throw in the forest for birds and animals to eat. He said, like a Chakravarti Samrat. He never said something different. Or is par stoop banana. So there was a tradition of a stoop earlier also. Of course, the earliest stoop, Sanchi, we find here. But there was a tradition of, even today, in our Hindu tradition, I am from Mithila, I must be elsewhere also, that whenever a person dies and there is a funeral, after some time, we called samadhi, we made samadhi. If a person is common person, just of soil, mitti, and if there is a big person or Raja, Maharaja and all, many, then we make some memorial like that. But that tradition was there since not, it did not start from Buddha, since Buddha's time only. That's why that familiar, that term was very much familiar. Build a stupa upon my relics. And we know that his relics were divided into 8 parts, 8 stupas were constructed. And later on, it is said that Ashoka broke those 8 stupas and divided into 84,000 parts. That is, of course, exaggeration, maybe exaggeration, but of course that was there. So the Buddha told like that. He never departed. So that's why he did not come from isolation, or he did not live in isolation. And that should be that should be understood in proper manner. Then only we can make a comprehensive study of Buddhism. A few points I jotted down. The bigger section, or a very prominent section, which does not take or does not accept the Buddha's tradition of karma and rebirth, that was Babasaheb Ambedkar. And he departed fundamentally from Buddhist teachings. We should not take him totally negatively. I don't take him, because he had a certain problem with his community. And he thought that if he accepts previous birth and later birth, then it may be said that, okay, all those Shudras were born because of their previous karmas. So that's why, in a limited sense, he rejected that. He rejected even the Jatakas, the 547 previous birth stories of the Buddha, which is very much there in the Pali text. And we have no right to reject them. But anyway, he had certain problems, so because of that, but later on, he wrote a text called The Buddha and His Dhamma, which is accepted or regarded as the Gita or as the Brahma Vakya by his followers. But even there, he talks about, very in brief, in the last part of his book, he talks about Pratit Samutpad. He cannot deny that Pratit Samutpad cannot be denied. Of course, according to Lokayat, we are confined to this life only. We don't accept previous or next, because if somebody dies, he does not come back to tell his experience. And even if he comes back, we won't believe. So that is there. But this life, if two children, even twin, are born in the same family with the womb of his own same mother, we find different natures. We may guess so many things, biological causes, but we have that scope or validity to think over. There must be something in the past because of them. They were born at the same time, but they have different nature. Why? So there are certain questions. Again, of course, we are centered around doubt, the element of doubt that should be there. That doubt has brought us together in this hall to discuss the possible solutions in our own way. So I welcome the whole scholarly community, great scholars, great philosophers who have come here to assemble and think upon the possibility of ways and means of rewriting Indian philosophy in the modern perspective. There is necessity of that, because we are living in 21st century. So we cannot, we can of course be proud of our Vedic days, but we cannot go back. We are using mobile, we are using using internet. So how can, they were not, there was no mobile and internet and TV in the ancient days. They lived in their own way. The Buddha of course was a prince, but he had no air condition. Today we have all these things. We have, we don't wear dhoti kurta only or simply choga and kanchuki. We are living 21st century, so we have to think on the Indian philosophy and Indian spirituality. But I once again humbly appeal that we should keep in our mind the one ancient values that are still continuing. I don't have knowledge of Urdu shair and sher, but there is a saying, kya roma rola mar gaye aur kya ke hasti mirti rahi hamari. To ha, please tell. nahi So this is, thank you sir, so this is the, there is some element which has kept us or which has been keeping us alive, and we are still proud of that culture. So we should not forget our own ancient values, and if we think and write, rewrite our value, our philosophy, that will be most befitting to the modern age. So I stop here, and at the last, I express my deep gratitude to my elder brother, Professor Shastri Ji, Vice Chancellor of this university, who, despite the fact that I expressed my inability to ponder upon logic and all that, Professor Bhatt, he told them, no, you must come and you express your views. So I thought that because I am from the early Buddhism, and there are problems there also, the problem of translation, problem of editing. Suppose Professor Pandit Mahapandit Rahul Sankirtyayan, he wrote profusely on Buddhism and on various things, but and we bow down before that great scholar because he did some spade work. His spade work has also its own importance. Today at least, and I had read that he was traveling from Madras to Hong Kong by ship, and on the ship itself he translated the whole Vinaya Pitaka. He went to Tibet four times perhaps, and he worked as a servant in a family. And he used to take photograph of the manuscripts because Tibetans were not allowing him to take that. And sometimes he stole also. And he was keeping all those things stored somewhere in the some cave. And one day, those people also got doubtful that he might be a thief. He is taking all these, he's stealing our ancient texts. So, and Rahul Sankirtan also realized that, oh, I may be caught, I may be punished. So one night, on 20 khachar, he just loaded those manuscripts and he fled away from there. And there was no helicopter who could chase and caught him. So he came to India through Nepal, and his friend was K.P. Jaiswal, a famous historian and advocate of Calcutta High Court at that time. So he handed over everything to K.P. Jaiswal, Kashi Prasad Jaiswal, and those manuscripts, many have been worked on. Some people have edited some texts, and which were lost or just burnt in Nalanda. Those which were safe in Tibet, they were brought back, and many people, many scholars have done their work on editing their work. And there is a Kashi Prasad Jaiswal Research Institute in Patna, in the Patna Museum building. Of course, that is also in very shady condition, but still some people work there, they prefer to work. The main problem today is that we are finding scholars who do not know Sanskrit, who do not know Pali, who do not know Prakrit, but still they claim to be great scholars. So we, the scholars like Professor Jha, Professor Arunji, and all Sanskrit who are based on Sanskrit scholars or Sanskrit scholarship, and others also, that my sincerest appeal is that we should try to go to the original sources. That will give us proper insight. And that's all. I express my sense of gratitude to Sanchi University and Professor Shastri, who invited me and give this opportunity to be here. Professor Bhatt Sahab, to my Guruji, and all scholars. So thank you so much. Yeah.
Western philosophy and Indian philosophy, Western philosophy as individualistic, academic, whereas Indian philosophy is actualization, realization, practical. I think this is too naive to make a distinction. There is a variety of even Western philosophy. There is also a variety of Indian philosophy. Therefore, to dichotomize is, I think, is a mistake to my mind. Philosophizing, philosophical thinking, by any great mind from any part of the world is philosophizing, number one. Number two, when you say that Buddhist is a kind of an authority, even that is a mistake, because Buddha himself said, when my own thought and philosophy don't accept without examination. Therefore, to treat him as an authority is also, I think, a mistake. Lastly, yes, it is very important to understand and appreciate Indian philosophy, to know Sanskrit, Pali, Prakrit, but those who do not know, they are not scholars. Even that is also a mistake. They can be a scholar in their own way, in other field, but to understand, to appreciate, and the Indian philosophy proper, definitely, those three languages are essential. So these are my few comments. Thank you.
Okay. Let me respond. Of course, then let me respond to him. It was a general observation. It cannot be true in 100% because all are individualistic or all are universalistic. So anyway, regarding this examination of the Buddha's word, Buddha never called authority, and you have not listened to me properly. I myself told that he told himself that listen to my words, examine it. Don't accept it blindly because I have said it. I have myself said it. So perhaps you could not listen to it properly. And the third question was, secondary sources, of course, help. But there are problems, usually. Because if you depend upon the secondary sources only, those who have interpreted, they might have misinterpreted in their own way, might have. I don't say that it is essential. So there is a risk of that mistake. So as far as possible, I don't say that you confine to that only. So as far as possible, try to go to the original sources, and I never say that those who have not understood or have not studied Sanskrit, Pali, Prakrit, etc., they are not scholars. So please don't mistake it or don't misunderstand. But there is definitely those scholars who know the original sources, they do more justice with their learning. That's why my submission. Please.
This is a general question, Professor, but kindly raise the question of, elimination of doubt or resolving the doubt. Based on the, interpretations of doubt and nirnaya in the Nyaya and the Mimamsa, is it possible to interpret so that the honorable judges in the country would be of, it would be of great help to them, because while delivering judgment, there has been speculations and doubts and ambiguous judgments are there. Long ago, Markandeya Kadju delivered 3 judgments, landmark judgments based on Mimamsa. Is it possible for the for us here, the Nyayikas and the Mimamsaka, to come out with a very authoritative interpretation of doubt and Nirnaya, so that it will be of great help to our legal luminaries in the country, Professor Bhatji?
I think darshan ki karyashala hoti hai jahan doubt ho ya controversy bade shantipurna dhang se sab sunte hain. So I think to do the honors, I would request Professor Bhatt to please give mementos to our eminent speakers, Professor KC Pandey, Dr. Arun Mishra and Professor Vaidyanath Love.